for lunch. Next, I'm going to bats. This is the southern bent-wing bat coming up. We're at the Naracoorte Caves, and this is one of only two places where the southern bent-wing bat exists. These are breeding colonies, and if something were to happen to this particular cave, these bats would be basically out of business. But I'm at the Naracoorte Caves in South Australia for a slightly different reason.
I'm at the Naracoorte Caves, and the fellow behind me is a diprotodon. Think of him as an overgrown wombat. Used to be lots of large creatures like this in Australia.
In the deep past, Australia had birds even too large for Sesame Street, 10 feet tall and 1,500 pounds. The biggest bird ever known, even bigger than Madagascar's elephant bird, which became extinct about 500 years ago. This bird probably became extinct because it tasted like chicken.
Millions of years before man set foot on the Australian continent, the landscape was dominated by huge beasts.
We had a whole range of large animals, a bunch of giant kangaroos and huge wombats the size of small cars. And at that time, it was kill or be killed, and it was pretty well cutthroat.
At the top of the food chain was a vicious killer. Much of what scientists knew about this creature, however, was simply speculation.
I have absolutely no doubt that an animal the size and bulk of Thylacoleo could have pulled down much larger animals, bigger than itself, like a giant wombat, Phascolonus, the size of a small car, or giant herbivorous kangaroos. That's the sort of creature that would have been fodder for Thylacoleo.
The picture of a remarkable creature is beginning to emerge. A creature so unusual, it has no close relative in today's animal world.
This is one of the most fascinating mammals I think it's ever been discovered. It's an animal that's full of paradoxes. There's nothing quite like it exists anywhere else in the world.
This is Thylacoleo carnifax. Now, Thylacoleo carnifax means, well, the thyla part means that it's pouched. And the coleo, the leo part, that means it's a lion. And the carnifex, well, that means that it's a butcher. And this butcher stood about 2 feet tall at the shoulder, and it was about 5 feet long. The maximum weight of Thylacoleo carnifax was about 350 pounds. It was first described in 1838, but in 1858 it got its first scientific description. Sir Richard Owens was the person that did that. He's the person that coined the word dinosaur. One of the things that's most interesting about Thylacoleo carnifax is the hand. This hand actually does have 5 digits. And one of those digits is an opposable thumb, and there are great claws at the end of each one of them. The hand is, in fact, very, very possum-like. That shouldn't be too unusual. After all, it's a marsupial, and so is a possum. But the idea is that those hands were used for climbing.
Mammals usually have one of three types of feet. Either they're plantigrade, like we are, they walk on their whole foot. They're digitigrade, they walk on their toes like a cat or a dog, or they're undulagrade, which means that they run on their toenails, that is, hooves in the case of horses or such. In the case of Thylacoleo, he was plantigrade. He walked on his entire foot. His foot was very much like the foot of a possum. And that sort of foot is not particularly good for running. What it is good for, however, is climbing.
Now, Thylacoleo carnifax was not the only predator on the Australian bush. There were also Komodo dragons that made today's Komodo dragons look quite small. They were up to about 20 feet long. And Thylacoleal carnifax probably had to defend its kill against thylacines and other animals as well, and we'll talk about the thylacines later. But my point is that it may have been very leopard-like in its behavior. It might have pulled its kill up into the tree, and if it was a female, it might have had to have pulled its babies up also. After all, it was a marsupial. In some ways, this animal was very cat-like. For instance, those claws that I told you about, those were retractable claws, and that means they could keep sharp. Extra good for climbing, extra good for getting hold of things. One of the things that Thylacoleal had that no modern animal really has is those two front incisors, and no one really knows how those were used. They could have been used to puncture the prey initially and then draw the meat back into the mouth, where those shearing teeth in the back come into play, and it might have been able to lop off big chunks of meat that way. Now, one of the ways that we know that the Thylacoleal was in fact a carnivore is because we found its kill. That is, some wombats and some kangaroos. And these animals have the clear bite marks that you would have from a Thylacoleal. And because that bite is so unusual, those bite marks are very distinctive.
This huge single cutting tooth here, or premolar tooth, and this large premolar tooth, cutting premolar tooth up here, are unprecedented.
While I was on Tasmania, I ran into something interesting. The dentation of a juvenile Tasmanian devil, not an adult, which you see in the lower right, and the Thylacoleal, which is in the upper left, is remarkably similar. The incisors protrude forward. There is a gap between the juvenile devil's incisors and its molars.
The Thylacoleal had a large jaw, and it was very powerful. In fact, it was more powerful than that of any mammal alive or extinct. As a matter of fact, the only thing that really comes close is the dire wolf, which existed back when there were woolly mammoths roaming around North America. Now, we know that the bite strength was that strong because of a study that was done, and it was published in the Proceedings of the Royal Society, Series B. Now, that was published in March 2005.
The force of Thylacoleo's bite was immense. Its jaw muscles were so powerful that it could outbite every known mammal, living or dead, including the extinct saber-toothed tiger.
There is another study that correlates the brain size of an animal with its jaw bite. And as the jaw bite becomes stronger, the brain size becomes smaller. Placental mammals generally have about 2.5 times the amount of brain power that marsupials have. And the result is marsupials have the capacity of having extremely high amounts of bite pressure. Thylacoleal had fairly short rear legs. And as a result of that, we assume that it probably wasn't running after its prey. Instead, perhaps it was an ambush hunter. One other possibility was that it climbed trees like a drop bear. And like a drop bear, it waited for its victim to get underneath, and then it jumped on top of the back of the victim and killed it.
Interestingly enough, those stories about a drop bear originate with the Aborigines of Australia. Maybe they saw the Thylacoleal and called it a drop bear or something like that. In any event, there are carnivorous marsupials that do drop out of trees and kill their prey, like this quoll, for example.
Brain endocast studies show that the Thylacoleal had good vision, good ability to smell, and good hearing. All three very important for a predator. The Thylacoleal was almost certainly run into extinction by people one way or the other. People probably didn't go out and kill the Thylacoleal, although that is a possibility. It is possible that people killed off all the animals that the thylacoleal depended on. Or it is possible that humans brought in dingoes, which they did, and that the dingoes killed off their prey. The thylacoleal's closest relatives today are the koala and the wombat. Recent DNA studies suggest that the wombat is actually quite closely related.
A creature at the end of its own evolutionary lineage.
But my perceptions at this moment are of a opportunist, carnivore, scavenger that hunted at night.
Thylacoleo carnifex, the marsupial lion, the lost predator from Australia's past, will never walk this way again. But the footprints it has left behind will continue to build the big picture of life on this planet for many years to come.
Well, if you pause for a moment and think about Australia, what is Australia's great heritage? Australia's great heritage is its flora and its fauna. And its marsupial fauna is absolutely unique. And this is the biggest marsupial carnivore that ever lived on this continent. And this animal was around at about the time that the first humans ever entered Australia.